especially when we face changes that we don't understand. It becomes natural or maybe even an internal desire to seek out those places that are familiar and safe so that we can try and make life just a little bit more predictable. When life gets difficult or when we become lost, confused, or afraid, and the chances and changes of life become more than we seem to have the mental fortitude to endure, we resort back to what evolutionary psychologists call fight or flight. We flee to what is comfortable. There is something hardwired in us, a deep desire to go home when things are not right. And so, we try and find that in the story about Peter and the other disciples who've gone fishing this morning. Because we, like they, try to go back to the way it was before, to something safe and something familiar, and often we recover old patterns of behavior and thinking, and although we may think or know better, we just go backwards. It's easier and it's more natural. It's in the midst of that emotion that we find Peter this morning, Peter and six others to be precise, because they returned to the sea. They'd gone back to doing the very same thing they did before the Jesus preaching adventure to direct them happened. They had come back to the Sea of Tiberias, the very place where it all began. They went back to what they knew before there was a crucifixion, before there was a resurrection, before there was a watershed moment, but it might even seem insignificant because it's not found in any of the other Gospels. It's only found in John's Gospel. And perhaps it's because John was there. He's the one that we refer to as the disciple whom Jesus loved. It is he who writes it down when none of the other writers include it. Perhaps it's because they weren't there. Discipleship, the upper room, the cross, the empty tomb, the house with its locked doors for fear of the Jews. Now all that, push that back about 80 miles to the south. And then we see what Peter goes back to doing what he always did, fishing. He knows how to do that. It's familiar. It's comfortable. He's good at it. Perhaps as a way to transport him to a simpler life, a way in which he can get away from all the drama and the trauma. 3 years of following this itinerant preacher in what seems to be a failed experiment. And even more remarkably, there are others that are ready to go along and go right back to that life. If I know people, and I've seen this kind of crisis before, I sense that there's something very deep going on. Peter, the inner part of Peter, his inner child, if you will, is very wounded. And he is looking for something to heal him. There are no first century psychologists or psychiatrists. There's no one who's been trained to assist him with the ideas of grief and processing human emotion. And these last 3 years ended in immense trauma. My theory, however, is not that Peter is really trying to catch fish as much as he is fishing for an answer. Why did he go through this? Why did he follow this man? We can leave the places and the people of our lives, but often they don't leave us. They are shadowy reminders in our mind's eye. We can never escape ourselves or our lives. We can only process through it. Wherever you go, these shadowy memories follow. They can be dealt with. They can be repressed. But if they're dealt with, then the results often are a stronger person. One who's been tempered, kind of like steel is tempered in a fire. And they prevail not as victim, but as survivor. The other option is to repress it. And the inner turmoil of events processes not unlike shrapnel, if you've known someone who has been in war and has shrapnel in their body. eventually the shrapnel starts coming to the surface. And it has to be dug out of the skin. It's not very pleasant. And when you least expect it, psychologically, the blast from the past comes back to haunt you. Repression doesn't really work. It's not really helpful. Peter may have left Jerusalem, but he can't get away from 3 years of discipleship. The Last Supper, the arrest, a charcoal fire, we're going to get back to that in a minute, a charcoal fire, denials, three of them, which we'll get back to too in a minute, and a crowing rooster that as a herald sounds it all off, I told you, you're human. He cannot leave behind the cross of that empty tomb or the doors of the house that were shut for fear of the crowd around him. Even though those things he tries to put away from his mind, he perhaps still hears the words of the risen Savior saying, "Peace be with you." And so he fishes. He does the one thing that seems to make sense. And this very human Peter needs some form of resolution. Perhaps he's asking in the stillness of the moment, who was this Jesus that I followed? Or perhaps who is he? Who am I? What can I do now? Where will I go? What does my life mean now? What's going to happen to me? All the typical things that all of us who go through trauma experience in our anguish. Peter's searching for meaning and a way forward. So I ask you this morning, do you see yourself in that kind of processing? Do you see yourself in those questions, those really hard questions that ask, how do I go on from here? Not alone. This is part of the human condition. If you're like me, you see your path like a journey. It's an endless process of trying to go forward and at the same time, process what I see when I look back. Where was God in the midst of this? And sometimes it's helpful to have someone come alongside you and help you process through these things. A process we call either therapy or spiritual direction or pastoral intervention. But all of us occasionally need those times in safety and in trust to process through the journey that we're on or the journey we have been on. And try to find a way to move forward. Children, you have no fish. And when we are looking for all the answers that we cannot solve on our own, we have no fish. We have nothing to say for our going back and trying to process the way things used to be. You have no fish. Jesus says this more of a statement of fact than a question. And Jesus does not really care, though, about whether or not they've succeeded in how many fish they have caught. He's not there for that reason. He is commenting on the status of Peter's empty self. Peter is searching while he's living in pain. He's not gone from darkness into light. He's not gone, really, psychologically, from the Good Friday event to the resurrection event. He's not there. He's still trapped in his own experience. On the other side of the boat is to switch a mindset from a Good Friday experience where all is death to where Jesus says, put it on the right side of the boat. Take it over into the resurrection and see what life you can experience. So Jesus then becomes a loving therapist. He casts his net with him. It's a euphemism for stepping out of the pain that we knew well and into some very uncharted waters of what could be, and to make some choices as to whether or not we choose to recover. Jesus is not making this as a command to Peter. Rather, he's making a subtle suggestion for a better way, stretching him in a very non-judgmental and a very unconditional manner. And there are times in my life when I look back and I see Peter's fight in me.
I tried and I failed each and every time because I went back instead of going forward. The job of the church is to find those struggling in the darkness of the Good Fridays of life and bring them over on the other side of the boat. And show them the light of Easter. Show them that trials and traumas of life don't have to define us. The past is a story. And really, once we get to that point where we can process through that and recognize that, we can go through to something really helpful. There's hope. There's a place to go. And God's already there. In Eucharistic prayer B, which we use all during the season of Easter, we see this hope written out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. It's like the author is saying, out of the left side of the boat into the right side. Out of that which fails to that which succeeds, because God does that work. We can't. And so in so doing, we see and proclaim the same thing. This is the Lord. We experience resurrection ourselves personally because we see that the things that are the traumas of our life don't have to own us. And when we see that it is indeed the Lord there, trauma is processed and healed. A victim is turned into a survivor. Old bad decisions are no longer plagued by the specter of guilt. New, get this, charcoal fire kindles openness in the place of the cold ashes of shame. The Last Supper is going to become now the first breakfast. Love is going to be overcome, or fear is rather overcome by love. Sadness is overcome by joy. Endless night is overcome by the dawning of the new day. Again, I ask you, can you resonate with Peter? Has an old decision that you made, maybe 1, 5, 10, 30 years ago, haunted you? Perhaps going back to the old thing no longer works for you either. Jesus encounters him on the beach with a charcoal fire. The word charcoal only shows up in the entire Bible twice. The first time, Peter warms his hands at a charcoal fire, the exact moment that a cock crows, symbolizing that he has denied Christ 3 times. 3 times. And here Jesus has the charcoal fire, the same smell, probably bringing back some very old memories when he is speaking with Simon at this point. Not Peter, Simon. Simon, do you love me more than these? Yes. In the original language, we see that Simon, which is his old name, means pebble. Does not mean rock. It means a tiny dwarf of what could be. A pebble. The word here that Jesus uses is, do you love me, agapeo, or from which we get agape. Do you love me in a divine, altruistic way? And Peter does not reply with that. He replies with what he knows. It shows up in our translation as just simply, do you love me? Yes, I love you. But there's more being said here. Jesus says, do you love me with self-emptying love? And Peter says, I love you like a brother. In reply, Jesus says, feed my lambs. Now, Peter is actually making an affirmation here. He's making an affirmation, and in these 3 settings here, Jesus is allowing him the psychological ability to process beyond 3 denials into 3 affirmations. He redeems himself. And he uses that same charcoal fire to make sure he knows that's what he's doing. Second time. The exchange happens. Jesus uses the word agape again. Do you love me, Peter or Simon, with a self-emptying love? And Peter says, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, you know I love you like a brother. Feed my sheep. And then a third and final time, and we see some frustration here, Jesus asks Simon, son of John, do you love me? And this time, Jesus switches the use of love. Simon, do you love me like a brother? And Peter is able then to reply, when he's replying out of frustration. We don't see that. We see that it's Peter's frustration about being asked three times. It's really not about that. It's about this subtle word that switches. Because now Jesus is approaching Peter where Peter is, instead of what his expectation eventually should be. Simon is frustrated because he doesn't get the idea that he can love in the same manner. Peter's frustrated at his own trauma. He knows that he cannot love in the same way that God loves. But he's also traumatized. He's also suffering. He has pain. And again, we see ourselves. And he says, feed my sheep. By going outside of yourself, you can find some hope for who you are right now. In the midst of trauma, it helps to process with other people, to love them along the journey. It is in giving that we receive. Now, Jesus has employed some serious psychotherapy here. He's used the charcoal fire, and he has used the process of affirming three times again, where once there were only three denials. But in the midst of this, Peter is able to affirm his love, and he is able to let go of what it was that he left behind at the first charcoal fire. Jesus' therapy goes with Peter beyond a breakfast on a beach into a new reality. The pebble is now again the rock. This human, frustrated, and internally tortured man who went back to the lake because he didn't know what else to do, is now going to be sent on, of all places, to Rome. And it is there that he will face courageously a martyr's death. This is no longer just a simple pebble. This is a man who has been transformed. So then I ask you, in the trauma and pain of this life, do you want the same type of restoration? And although Jesus offered it once to Peter in very specific ways, the church has been offering it in the sacraments and in godly counsel for nearly 2,000 years. Draw nigh and take the body of the Lord to your own comfort. And know that on four other days of the week, there is a listening and a loving ear downstairs ready to meet you when you need it. And sometimes you may find that your yesterdays seem too dark for tomorrow. It's okay. God's already there. He's ready to put light into it. Sometimes it's scary to open up the tomb and find out it's empty. Sometimes that is scary, but necessary to move on. To move on from being the pebble that failed to being the rock that was a powerful witness for Christianity. In Jesus, the past can be sealed, the trauma can be processed and put away, the pain can be converted to passion, and torture can be converted to triumph. God is still very much in the business of restoring us. That's the job of the church. That's the job as my job as your priest. So maybe now it's time, instead of going out fishing, to come out into Galilee. It's time to change the way we've done things just because we've always done them. We are the Episcopal Church, and we're here for you, and for them, too.